Soumitro Banerjee did his BE in Electrical Engineering from Bengal Engineering College and M.Tech and PhD from IIT Delhi. He was a professor of Electrical Engineering at IIT Kharagpur before moving to the Physics Department of IISER Kolkata. Professor Banerjee is elected fellow of all the science academies of India, the World Academy of Sciences, Institute of Electrical and Electronics Engineers, West Bengal Academy of Sciences, and the Indian National Academy of Engineering. He is a recipient of Shanti Swarup Bhatnagar Award. He has several technical books and articles to his credit, and is a recipient of 2004 Citation Laureate Award. As the General Secretary of BSS, he also has written numerous articles and books on the history and philosophy of science. May I request Professor Banerjee to give his talk now.
I am a follower of Professor Palashbharan Par in various ways, and one of the ways is not to talk with slides. So I'll prefer to just address. Today's topic is very important because here in this gathering, we are trying to figure out, as I said, the path that we should take to take our science forward. And one of the things that is looming in the horizon is the major problem of unethical practice in science that we are witnessing. And unless the scientific community squarely addresses this problem, the way we are trying to develop science in India cannot happen. And therefore, this is a very important matter of discussion today. But then when we discuss ethics, you can talk about ethics in various different areas. Ethics of medical science, ethics of scientific research, ethics of football, ethics of anything. So whatever we do, there are certain ethical practices, there are certain unethical practices. How do you identify them? Well, whenever we have some well-defined activity in which a group of people are engaged, for example, scientists are engaged in the action of science, footballers are engaged in football, doctors are engaged in curing people. Whenever a group of people are engaged in very specific activity, there are certain time-honored practices that are recognized as conducive to that particular field, helps that particular field, and there are certain activities, certain practices that are recognized for a long time as detrimental to that particular field. Those ones that are conducive to that particular field of activity, these are ethical, considered to be ethical for that particular field. In our case, we are scientists, we do science. In particular, this means that we try to find out the laws of nature, how nature functions. And in trying to find that, and in trying, oh, the coffee comes here, that's good. In trying to find that, the things that a scientist does, the activities that scientists do, whatever practices help that, those ones will be called ethical, and things that will be detrimental to that will be considered unethical. So in that context, let us consider and find out what can be considered ethical, what unethical. As you know, in the old times, people used to think in what is known as subjective way. I think, I believe, it's my thinking, so it is I, me, myself, the subject. While in the modern way of thinking in science, we have completely jettisoned that way. Since Galileo, Professor Chatterjee talked about Galileo at length, therefore I have to also mention this, that it was Galileo who brought in the objective way of thinking, where one says that whatever I think, whatever I believe may be wrong. And therefore, it is my job to figure out whether that is true or not. How do I figure out? By testing it against reality. And thus, objective way of thinking developed, which recognizes that I could be wrong. My beliefs could be wrong. My observations could also be wrong. So this is what the essence of science is, being objective. So anything that goes contrary to that objectivity would naturally be called unethical. And I'll cite examples of that. But there is a bigger problem looming. I mean, the reason I decided to talk without slides is that I intend to finish a little early so that you have larger time for interaction. So if I go by the slides, then I have to take that amount of time that is needed by the slides. So I intend to finish earlier. The other problem that we have is, in our society, science has become just a career. And all the problems that Professor Chatterjee mentioned, the problem of plagiarism, the problem of distortion of data, the problem of fabrication of data, all these happen because the people who are now doing science, they see this just as a career, any other career. I'm doing science, I could have done something else. Now, it is a major problem in our society that we are preparing students to take up careers in science, but just as career, not with a passion for science, not with a passion for finding out what is not known, but just to publish a paper, just to get some citations. And just so all that is essentially a careeristic goal. And unless we get rid of that careeristic goal, unless we can teach our next generation, the students, not to follow that careeristic goal, this problem will happen. This way or that. See, it has been every society that if you commit a murder, you will be hanged, guillotined, whatever. Has that ever been able to stop murder in the society? Every society has said that stealing is bad. Every religion has said that stealing is bad. Don't religious people steal? So just telling that, just making a rule, does not really happen. That doesn't really matter. Ultimately, it will keep on happening unless we change the reason for which it is happening. It is that people see it as a career, just a career. Therefore, they will do whatever it takes to further that career. And what does it take to further a scientific career? Publish more papers, get more citations. And in order to publish more papers, good papers in good journals, if you are unable to do it by yourself, if you are unable to get that kind of results, if you're really unable to break through, then you have to make it appear as if it is breakthrough. And how to do that? You cook up the data. Now, this is not now. It's not happening now. It has been happening for a long time. Take the case of Peeled Down Man. Have you heard of that case? Yeah. Soon after Darwin, when Darwin said that there has been some missing link, I mean, we have seen some ancient fossils and we see the modern man. In between, at that time, there was nothing found. So he sort of conjectured that there must be some missing link, and therefore people went around to find out those missing links. And at that time, a particular man, he claimed to have found such skull pieces, bones of the skull, from his own courtyard. So by digging, he was digging a well and found it. Well, when that is the case, people actually believed it. People actually tried to reconstruct the human history based on his apparent fossils. And only after 53 years, much later, much after he died a lord. He became a lord, and then he died. Later it was found that the skull that he claimed to be of an ancient man, it was basically a part of a chimpanzee skull, a part of a human jawbone. So it was sort of assembled out of different places. He put it in some chemical solution so that it turned brown, so it looks old, something like that. Why did it happen? Because he wanted to become famous. He wanted to make a career out of it. Now that, in those times, were few and far between. In those times. I mean, these were classic cases. But now it is no longer remaining classic. It is now becoming almost a household affair. Those of us who are in academic institutions, we have to handle such cases day in and day out. Small measure, People tend to ignore that. But the moment you ignore that, that person who has done it once will know that that kind of activity can be done and you can get away with it, and therefore he'll commit it again, commit it a bigger one again, so that way things grow. Take the case, a few years back, it was not very far back, 2014, a Japanese scientist claimed to have converted any human normal body cell into a stem cell. You know, it's a, if that can really be done, it's a breakthrough. It's a huge affair. It was almost a Nobel Prize matter. And then when other people tried to do it, he was not very clear about his procedure. And then when people tried to guess and tried to do it, they didn't get the same result, confronted. It was found that it was completely fabricated result. A Korean scientist in 2004, he claimed to have created, you know, nowadays cloning is very in thing, claimed to have created a cloned embryo of human embryo. That's a very, very big breakthrough because nobody has able to done it. Though it's a very ethical question whether it should be done or not, but he claimed. Again, it was found that it was never done, he just claimed. So these kind of things happen, and for some time they really become famous. This person in Japan actually went up the university ladder to become a very, very famous scientist. The person in Korea, he became recognized, he was awarded the pride of Korea before his downfall. And in our country also, a few years back, the geologists here would be able to recall that incident where a scientist claimed to have found certain fossils in Himalayas, and that those reports he reported for a period of, say, 20 years, and things were so became, these results are so startling that it went into sort of remolding the way we understood the biological evolution of this subcontinent. And later it was found some of these fossil pieces were sourced from some from Egypt, some from South America, put together, put somewhere in Himalayas, and next expedition he finds it. Things happen like that. Why did it happen? He wanted to become famous. For him it was just a career, just going up the educational ladder. So things are happening because we take it as a career. But actually, science demands certain things. Science demands, for example, absolute impersonality. It doesn't matter what I believe. It doesn't matter what I believe. My results, if they're different from what I believe, I have to accept that. Just take the example of Kepler. He believed, he had a peculiar belief that at that time it was known that there are only five planets. It was believed that there were only five planets, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn. Why five? He asked that question. And at that time it was known from the Pythagorean times that there are only five regular polygons. So he believed that each polygon is sitting one inside the other, and that way the whole universe is formed, and that was a sort of his own personal construct. And he went to Tycho Brahe to find out evidence for his own theory. He became a disciple of Tycho Brahe. Tycho Brahe died 1 year later, and the whole mass of data that Tycho Brahe had obtained by observing the actual motion of the planets came to the possession of Kepler. He then sat down with calculation. And the more he calculated, he found that it is not matching his data. He sat with the data, he tried to match for 10 long years, he didn't find it. And then finally he said that, then I must be wrong. Now that is the essence of the Renaissance of that time. I might be wrong, my thought may be wrong. That is the essence of objective way of thinking. And then we know that he converged on the elliptical motion of the planets and so on and so forth. releasing a whole line of activity. But then he did it by actually jettisoning his own personal beliefs. Now, since this is so important, science has it built into its system that in no way my own personal beliefs can interfere with my results. For example, if suppose I propose that I claim that I have discovered a medicine for, say, malaria. Suppose I claim that. Will the scientific world immediately accept it? No, I have to prove it. How do I prove it? People who are not exposed to the methods of science may think that I'll apply it to a few people and if they get cured, then let's imagine medicine. No, it's not that way. Because it may so happen that the people who have applied it on were not really that kind of patients. There are variations of patients. There are variations of their own personal power of resistance and so on and so forth. Therefore, that is not a proof. So what do I have to do? I have to collect a large number of samples of people suffering from the same disease, say 100. Then we have to divide it into two parts. The one part, 50, may be called the experimental group. Another part, 50, may be called the control group. I apply that supposed medicine on the experimental group, and I do not apply the supposed medicine on the control group. And then, after some time, I take a statistical survey of the result of the... Is it okay? It is not okay. It is not okay because of various reasons. A, the person who is experimented on, he or she may think that I have not got that medicine, therefore I must die. I'll not get cured. And therefore, the standard practice is to give a something that looks and feels like the medicine, but it's not the medicine to that person, so that nobody knows whether I have taken the medicine or not. Is it okay? No. The person who is administering the drug and the person who is actually doing the test, say, for example, taking the blood sample and counting the number of parasites in the blood sample, if he or she believes that this particular hypothesis is true, then he might miscount. Say, 135 number he has to count, and he might count it less, count it more, depending on his own belief. Therefore, that's also not allowed. Therefore, what we do is that the person who is making the measurement doesn't know whether the person's blood is from the control group or the experimental group. This is called a double-blind experiment. Why do we do this? We do this in order to eliminate any possibility of our personal belief standing in our way, either of the experimenter or the experimented. Now, if we put in that kind of security, still we find that wrong results are claimed every now and then. Just open the newspaper every day. You will find once one claim is coming, the next few days another completely opposite claim is coming. Both claim to be scientific. Why is it happening? Because there is a huge amount of still data fabrication. Not only that, there are also issues where certain lines of research are promoted, financially supported, in order to prove certain things. Just imagine the kind of results that have been reported in the first few years regarding the genetic propensity of the black people to be prone to crime. Papers have been published. The studies have been financially supported. Why? With some motive. And the scientists also find that there is money, and therefore we must do this. And the scientists therefore have the responsibility of producing results that are conducive to that. So right now, if you see, you will find that in many countries, this kind of bogus research are going on, which are funded with some specific objective. And scientists, now here comes the question of ethics, even though they are trained in the method of science, how science should do, how science should act, they still argue with themselves that if I do proper science, I'll not get any funding. And if I do this science, I'll get some funding. Why not do this? And they do. Imagine at the time of the Ronald Reagan, if you recall, he was the president of United States for some years, and he had a pet project called Star Wars program. That means his idea was that in future the wars will be fought from the skies, and therefore he pumped in huge amount of money in Star Wars research. And money in other fields sort of started drying up. Scientists started writing project proposals on the Star Wars program. Scientists who did completely different things started writing. And then they used to get money, they used to do, and through that, a huge amount of, killing machines have been made, whose effects we are now seeing. Iraq war was practically like a movie. People saw people suffering as if somewhere it's happening. From far distance, we are killing person. How did this happen? Why did this happen? Because there was a research in it. Scientists did research on that. Why? Because there was money in it. For their own career, it was needed. Now, I would like to raise that question. Should we do that kind of science? Do not go that far. Only the last year, in IIT Delhi, there was a workshop in which what was discussed? The medical benefits of Gomutra and other various gobar and other goes and things. Who were participating? Scientists. Why are they participating? Why are they proposing projects? And because in other fields of science, money is drying up. If you submit project proposal in other fields, you are not getting the money. But if you submit just any junk proposal in this particular field, you'll get money. So scientists are now, some scientists, I will not say scientists, some scientists are now inclined to do research on Gomutra. So this is another problem of ethics. We should make our younger generation sensitive to this particular fact. No, science is not done this way. Don't do junk science. There's another issue, I'll discuss that and then I'll try to end. That is, when we do science, we base ourselves on what is already known, what other people have already done. And I could not have done that science if they made it inaccessible to me. Right? So if the knowledge that is already available, the knowledge that is already generated is not accessible to me, I would not be able to do any science. I am able to do any science by the fact that they made it accessible. Newton did not say that whatever law I discover is only my law. Nobody should know it. Nobody should work on it. Einstein did not say that. So now there is a issue that is not only coming, but sort of being legitimized in the name of intellectual property. So far, I live in a house, it's my property. I have this field, it was my property. Now it's saying that I have thought something, it's my property. Now, if we really go by that, can science progress? When I am doing a scientific work, I am basing myself on somebody else's work, and I could do it because I got to know about it. And if that is protected by intellectual property of, say, Maxwell, can I research on Maxwell's law? So if Einstein's theory of relativity is protected by intellectual property, can science progress? Yet, this intellectual property matter is now becoming sort of buzzword. I mean, people are accepting as if it is in. Nobody's questioning that. Yes, we need to question that. Yes, we need to question that. See, when the possibility came for Madame Curie to patent her discovery, radium, because that stood to gain a huge amount of money because that was hugely beneficial for medical science, she refused. She refused, saying that it is a property of the humankind. Whatever I have done, I have based myself on the property of humankind, and therefore whatever I have done is also property of humankind. This approach is now slowly changing and is giving rise to what is known as the patent regime. Whatever I produce is either my or my sponsor's personal property. And that way, it is hindering the progress of science. I said that whatever is conducive to the progress of that particular area is ethical. Whatever is not conducive is unethical. I would say this is unethical. But it is becoming a very natural thing. Whenever I receive the applications for faculty positions, they say that this many papers, this many patents, fine. I mean, they think that is quite fine. But nobody ever questions that. The moment you are patenting something, you are making it not available to humanity. You are only making it available to your company that buys that patent. And because of that, you see the amount of, why are we not discovering a cure for cancer? Because every company is doing research on their own and nobody knows what the other company does. Every academic faculty member is sponsored by this company or other, and every result that the person produces is the property of that company. And therefore, there's a huge amount of, you know, intellectual barrier, no free flow of information, and therefore the field is growing slowly. This is not conducive to the progress of science, and that's what I'm saying. We need to question that. So far, we are used to this regime. We are not questioning that. We need to question that. With that, I will end so that there are possibilities of further questions. Thank you very much.